Item number one, drug paraphernalia.
Mr. Chairman, would you like me to start this one?
You've got some guests.
Well, I do, Councilman. I don't know what order you want to.
No, please. I don't want that's fine.
No, that's okay. I don't know how you have thought through the presentation of this, about whether it's.
Why don't you let me set up the law real quick, and then you can turn it over to whoever wants to speak.
There's just a young man who read about it and asked to come speak.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, at a previous work session, the board had requested that we at least take a look at the law regarding the sale or the county regulation of drug paraphernalia items. And what I have done primarily is look at it from the perspective of preemption. That's the biggest concern that I have with respect to this sort of thing. First of all, let me set the stage. The drug paraphernalia items that we're talking about are basically things and items that you can buy at certain stores that are used to inhale or otherwise make use of things like marijuana or spiced marijuana or those sorts of things that are, quite frankly, controlled substances under Georgia law. And I think that a concern of the board is how can it be that these can be freely purchased out in just the regular areas of commerce available to young people, et cetera, when they appear to be, they clearly serve one purpose and one purpose alone.
That also includes the spice or K2 as well.
I think so. In any event, so my concern primarily is preemption, the notion that if something is governed by Georgia law, and particularly if it's the subject of a Georgia statute making it criminal, the typical rule is that county governments can't really make something criminal that's already a crime under Georgia law. In other words, we can't just adopt a code that makes a criminal act criminal because it's already codified, it's already done. So we went out and looked at that, and of course there is a statute on point, board members, and that is 1613.32 that already bans the sale, transfer, or display of drug-related objects, is what the state law calls them, which are any instrument, device, or object which is designed or marketed as useful primarily for one of the following purposes. For instance, to inject, ingest, inhale, or otherwise introduce marijuana or a controlled substance into the human body, to enhance the effect of marijuana or a controlled substance on the human body, to test the strength, effectiveness, or purity of marijuana, etc. You get the idea. So there's a state law and a criminal statute section of the state code already on this issue. And then OCGA 1613.32.1A provides it shall be unlawful for any person to sell, rent, lease, give, exchange, distribute, or possess any of those objects. So there is a state law that addresses this. Now, therefore, we can't adopt a county code that looks like that. Okay, we can't do that. We've got a state law that says that. There are some other jurisdictions, however, that have gotten a little clever with how they try and regulate in this area by basically taking those definitions and linking them to either a loitering or a disorderly conduct ordinance provision. That basically says that if you're found out and about with these items in your possession, then you can be guilty of this offense under the local code, loitering or disorderly conduct. So you see, they're not duplicating the criminal statute. They're using the criminal statute as a springboard to then find you in violation of another area of the local code, specifically Rockdale County and the city of Villarica. Have done those, and I think that's in your packet. So I say all that to say there may be a way to address this by way of sort of taking those definitions of what's already illegal under state law and then trying to draft a code that would somehow make it a violation to use those same implements, but we're not finding criminality by the mere sale of those implements, but perhaps by the possession of them in some sort of a disorderly conduct context. And I'll say that with some reservation. I don't know that Rockdale County or the city of Villarica have ever been challenged on a preemption basis, but they're out there.
Who would challenge a preemption? Somebody that's been arrested?
Absolutely. And some of it's been cited. Okay. They would have to make
it. Somebody wants to open the shop.
Yeah. Well, how about the jurisdictions that have put this stuff out of sight?
that's another way of potentially addressing it would be by way of augmenting and strengthening the state law. In other words, we're not saying that it's a criminal to, we're not saying it's criminal to possess them, but to the extent that you have these items available for commercial sale, you've got to put them out of sight. Now, the only problem I have with that, though, is that since there's a state law that says it's illegal to even sell them, if you then say, but put them out of sight, you don't want to give mixed messages to your retailers.
The retailer argues that it's for tobacco use. They're not drug paraphernalia. I used to smoke. I quit about 5 years ago. I always had real pretty bongs to smoke my Marlboros in. But, you know, we could do that. The other thing is the K2 or spice. That's a part of this that we want to try to. I know that many cities, counties, and states are struggling with it right now, but it's something that I believe, anyway, is important for this board to try to figure out how to get a grasp on here at home. You know, we have teenagers dying with this stuff. And, Captain, I'm not here to put you on the spot, but I know that I've had deputies tell me all the time they're going to calls where 14, 15, 16-year-old kids are they're out. They're completely zonked out, nearly dead. And I think it's something that we've got to try to get a handle on. That's kind of a springboard, if you will, to this young man that contacted me. I'm not going to try to underscore it. He's a young man that my son's known since fourth grade. But when he found out about this, he called me. Taylor, if you want to just come sit down here, come up to about that laptop. He wanted to tell the board, and I asked the chairman if it was okay, about an experience that he had and what he has seen. So this is Taylor LeBaron.
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, I have a story to tell. Why should you listen to me, first of all? I'm only 19, but I'm being the activist for my generation. I'm trying to see things in a different light, in a different picture. It wasn't until February 27th of this year that I really understood what this spice or synthetic marijuana or K2 was. My brother, who turned 17 this January, tried to take his life. He failed in doing that. The thing that almost took his life was spice, the synthetic marijuana. I knew he smoked it. I never purchased it for him, but I knew he did it. It's kind of like when you know somebody uses drugs for recreational use, you don't see a problem, and then everything implodes. Spice is dangerous beyond belief. It's different than alcohol. It's different than real cannabis. It's different than tobacco. I have never heard of somebody smoking marijuana once and just dying. I've never heard of one person smoking one cigarette or having one drink and dying. It does happen, but it's not something that happens where there's so many cases within one county. Over the past several years, we have had a store called Puff and Stuff, which is located directly across the street from Movies 400. We have Smoke and More Smoke Shop, which is right down the road from Puff and Stuff. We also have King John's Smoke Shop, which is located off exit 17 on Highway 400. Spice is something that is completely different than marijuana. It is something that can kill you instantly. It is playing Russian roulette with your life. I've seen my brother be carried away on a stretcher because his heart stopped. This does more than just gives you a high. The reason, I'm no doctor. I do not claim to know anything medically, but from what I have done personal research on, the high that you get from this is because it eats at your internal organs. It eats your brain cells, and the high you get is because your body's dying. It's different and more severe than smoking real marijuana or doing any other type of government-regulated drug. This needs to be stopped. I was away at college up north, and I still was interconnected to local news via the internet. And I saw several young people go to hospitals, even die because of this. This is something that people think it's fine. The reason I never spoke up before or said anything before when I knew my brother was doing this is because I'm 19. I know what it's like to be a teenager. I know what it's like to make mistakes. I know what it's like to want to try to get that release of emotion. You want to escape. Bullying can have a major effect on people's psychological development. I've been bullied all of my life since I was 5 years old, and that has impaired me. I suppose that's one of the reasons why a lot of people choose to use this. They think it's a legal and safe alternative. My brother and I thought that the reason that it was able to be legally sold is because it was safe, it was synthetic. I have spoken to several Forsyth County officers. I'll just stop at a petroleum station, and I'll see an officer, and I'll stop there, and I'll talk to them, and I'll ask them, what is there being done about this issue? There are too many young people who are dying over this. This is something that is inconceivable. It's gotten way out of control, and it is our responsibility as not only a county, a state, but as a nation to put an end to this, because if people do not take action, then we will lose this generation. The reason that people think it's safe is because you can buy it. You do not get arrested. I have asked a Forsyth County officer point blank the night that my brother almost died, is there any way that you can get arrested for this substance? If I get pulled over and I have the paraphernalia or the actual spice or drug itself, can you get in trouble? The answer is no. There is no law, there is no fear that you can inject in adolescents. You cannot control adolescents. You may think you can, but the truth is that when the brain isn't fully developed until 25. So I really think that something needs to be done about this, and I'm here to help. I want to be an activist in this. And Mr. Bell has my information, and I would be more than willing to donate my time and effort into doing whatever it takes to get this product off of the market in this county, and eventually I want to take it to state and national level. I thank you.
Thank you very much. Ken, kind of basically to this point in our booklet, you asked two questions. One is, can you have an ordinance banning paraphernalia? And two, in Forsyth County, ban spice marijuana? And you answered both of them. Your answer to number two, in short, as you point out in short, no, we can't ban spice because the state of Georgia has already listed spice as a controlled substance.
That's correct.
So a controlled substance under Schedule 1, I don't know Schedule 1 from Schedule, or Schedule I from Schedule Z, but if it's controlled, why are people able to sell it in the stores here in this county?
I don't know that individuals are, and I'm not going to, the speaker was obviously spoke from personal experience and had a lot of passion about it. I will just say this, that there is a law in the books. I think what you're seeing is the distinction between the law in the books and perhaps how it's implemented statewide. And, from the standpoint of the resources to focus on this particular element of the criminal law, I just don't know, how many resources we have devoted to that. And there's no question that it is a considerable problem. But I do think at least there is a statute that addresses it. Our weapons are going to be more limited because of the state law already on it. I think that to the extent that you would like me to go out and try to fashion an ordinance that can strengthen and augment the state law and try to provide some local regulatory power with respect to this, I'm happy to do that. It'll be a little, it'll have to be a little creative.
Can we have a permit required to sell tobacco paraphernalia, like an alcohol type permit?
I think this city of Kennesaw actually does something along those lines, but sure. We could look into something like that. Limiting tobacco.
Preemption is something that we're going to have to deal with. But I, again, I'm only speaking for myself, not the board. I'm as prepared to get as creative as we need to and accept the fact that somebody may challenge it. I'm plenty prepared to do that. So if we need to license it, if we need to have it where it's out of sight, if it's, I've had firsthand experience with people under 18 to buy it, and you're supposed to be 18 to buy the tobacco products. So there's got to be different ways that we can creatively, if we can't totally ban it, we can make it so much trouble to sell it. You can't advertise it, you can't put a sign in the window that says that you have K2 or spice or anything. You know, all of those kind of things we can just, and I certainly don't want to create a negative tone here, but we can be pretty good at making things difficult on people. So why don't we do it for a good reason this time and make it so difficult, and they've got to pay a tax on it, and they got to pay a $5,000 license fee. So just make it so difficult that they're not going to sell it here.
Well, what is the it that you don't want them to sell? The spice?
Spice, K2, and in reality,
spice is already
illegal. It may or may not be. Tell me
it depends on what the ingredients are. The manufacturers keep changing.
That's what happens. They change the ingredient. GBI can't identify. You don't make a law for that exact chemical compound, and the chemist will change it. And you don't have a law to identify that exact chemical compound, and therefore it's illegal until they can identify it and make another law.
We keep chasing,
and they stay ahead of it.
But we can certainly come up with a creative way that it doesn't matter what the components are, but if the product, whatever it may be, however we can describe it, we know what it's for. They can call it bath salts or anything they want to, but we know what it is. There's got to be a way we can make it difficult and expensive for the seller.
It's a concept. That you'd have to specifically describe that type of tobacco outside of other tobaccos.
Then the other things, the bongs and all that stuff, again, you know, reality is it's difficult for me to believe the government needs to sometimes regulate that kind of stuff. I don't like government to regulate morality. I don't think that's government's job. But the fact is we have to protect some of the teenagers that are going in and buying this stuff because people don't care if they sell it to them.
But shouldn't this be an ordinance that if we don't go in with the city to come and watch the, I mean, if they keep doing what we don't want people doing in the county, what's going to drive the business up here?
I would hope that the city of Cumming would go along. They usually do adopt our ordinances, mm-hmm. Commissioner, but if they choose not to, that's for them to deal with it.
That'd be a shame.
I would not want to not do something because they wouldn't want to go along.
I mean, just include them in the conversation that we know what we consider.
Yeah,
I mean,
they usually will adopt most of our ordinances that are on that kind of stuff, and we should.
You can't, do you have any idea how you will specifically separate regular tobacco from this? I guess if there's some kind of a chemical additive to the spice or such, it'll have to just be vague that can't be anything added to it.
Let me offer up just a practical difficulty. If we start getting into the chemical qualities of a particular substance,
how are you going
to even know that we have the
GBI can't keep up with it.
Technical capability to do that. Look, the state law says that a synthetic cannabis, known as synthetic marijuana or K2, is illegal. We know that. So we would have to do something other than that. And you all are telling me that keeping up with the chemical composition of this is challenging, even for the state GBI crime lab. It's going to be hard for code enforcement.
What if it has any chemical additive to it? Tobacco.
And wait a second. I mean, you're going off the deep end here.
No, we can't do that.
There are all sorts of regular tobacco. I mean, there's cigars that have sugar or some sort of sweetener on the tip, which might be considered a chemical. There's all kinds of stuff in tobaccos that is chemical in nature.
Have you guys given any thought?
But what we can do is maybe we can't perhaps make it illegal again, as you're suggesting. But again, we can get creative to make it difficult.
If you could put in the wording anything that's not regulated by the FDA tobacco, it doesn't have a tobacco stamp, it's against county ordinance.
Because most of the spice and this K2 does not have any.
Well,
there's an angle.
Wait, let me ask. So if it doesn't have a stamp, mothballs don't have a stamp. So I can't have mothballs.
You're talking about going a little deep.
I'm trying to understand something that's plagued society for thousands of years, which is drug use and drug abuse. What you're saying is, if it contains tobacco of any kind and does not have a drug stamp, it ought to be outlawed. Is that what you're saying?
That's the easiest way I would think to word it into an ordinance.
I tend to like that idea.
We just need to, it's a difficult challenge because we have to address state law, we've got to address constitutionality, we've got to, you know, if somebody's 18 and they want to smoke a legal product, mainly my concern is these teenagers that are smoking it and dying in people's backyard, dropping dead.
It's not only that, it's the ingredient in whipped cream, nitrous oxide. If you inhale it, you have people that are dying all the time just from inhaling that because they're inhaling too much. It kills the need for the brain to get oxygen, and it stops the lungs. So people come up with all kinds of inventive ways to get high and die.
See, my problem with the if it's not got a tobacco stamp, supposing they make what amounts to spice, if that's what it's called, and they put it on a binder that's not tobacco, they find some paper that you can smoke, then what are we going to do?
Well, we can't not do something because of what they might do. What we need to do is do something. And if they do something, we need to follow up and let them know that we're going to continue to helm them until they go somewhere else to sell. We're not going to ban it, but we need to. It's almost like massage parlors, which is something we need to address anyway. You know, we've got places that are therapy places, and we have others that are not so therapy places.
That's for another day.
Just because it's for another day, but you know, those are the kind of things that we need to let people know that Forsyth County is not interested in having. And we need to find ways to, you know, if we can't make it illegal, they just choose not to do business here. It's too costly to do business here, and they'll go somewhere else.
I'll have to agree with you.
With respect to board direction, then, would you like me to focus on two things? First of all, is some sort of a language pertaining to basically products that accentuate tobacco inhalation, which is what we're going to have to go through, right? Because we've already got a statute.
We can base it on what could be used for drug paraphernalia as well, which is their findings for tobacco use.
Well, if we make it for tobacco use, it's going to be a difficult argument for them to come to court and say, no, I'm in it for spice use, so it doesn't apply to me. So, man, that's a good place for us to be in. The harder one is going to be getting to the illicit drugs at all. That's, to me, the harder challenge.
Illicit drugs, meaning?
Well, yeah, I mean, that's what y'all are talking about, basically, is whatever's not regulated with a tobacco stamp, we're shutting it down. But as the officers already told us, there's so many things that you can get high on that aren't regulated or that are perfectly legal.
But to be lazy and do nothing?
Yeah, we got to at least do something, and if we see there's other issues, we need to address them. But just because somebody's putting whipped cream in cans doesn't mean that we ignore spice.
From our standpoint, if we see it, we will confiscate it, send it to the GBI, keep an active investigation. If it meets the criteria, then we take warrants. If not, then the police is off the street.
What can we do as a board to support the sheriff's office in enforcing the existing laws on this one? The state laws.
I really don't know, just right off the top of my head, but it'd be great if we could get together, maybe come up with a plan.
Because we've got some laws that we can go ahead, because again, if we can't outlaw it, we just make it miserable for them to be here and they'll go somewhere else.
Ken, the law says about marketing. Is there anything we can do? I mean, the difference between a meerschaum pipe that costs $300 or $400 and is in a fine tobacco shop and a 50 cent little ceramic pipe or something is not all that different. It's largely the difference in marketing, I think. You don't find a $300 meerschaum pipe usually at a convenience store.
But you still can't separate the value by the law. It has to have the residue of some illegal product in it.
Not if the law allows you a leg up on how you market it.
Well, I think you get the idea that, from my standpoint, I'm not speaking for the other board members. I think we can get as creative as we need to. We look at what other jurisdictions have done across the country and get creative and just run it out, push it on out of here. I mean, that's what the sheriff's office does now.
They're
going to keep things at bay.
And if you'll get with the sheriff's office, I'm sure they beat this thing to death and they've got some angles they might suggest you could take.
I know many deputies would love to be able to do something. They just can't.
Okay. One other thing I'd like to add. I know that if you are in drug court, that already, if you are in that process of trying to graduate from drug court, for you, that the individual that's in that situation, it's been quite a while now since drug court has said stuff like spice use to you is prohibited. You'll be thrown out of drug court graduation. I'm not sure all the rules, but somehow they must be able to know whether you smoke spice or, and I think it would be worth talking to Judge Bagley and other judges to see if there's some insight that they have into this that we could use at the marketing and direct purchase level.
Okay. I'll tell you what I'll do then. This has been helpful for a means of direction. I will get with the sheriff's office folks as well as the folks either in probation or the judge. Probation typically does a lot of the testing, so they're going to have some insight into that as well. And I will try and bring you back some specific options. I won't start legalized yet, but I'll bring you back specific options, and then you tell me how risk adverse you are as to which one we think about moving forward.
Kevin, would you be willing to, do you have anybody in your agency that specializes in this kind of stuff?
Yes.
Would you see if they'd be willing to work with Ken? And I'll be happy to help as well. I'm doing the research I can do out where the jurisdictions do, so it doesn't have costs associated to it.
Yes, I would be happy. Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Can we go on to the next item?
Okay.
We are skipping item number two, or it's been postponed until April the 10th, according to my notes, and we're then at item three on the attorney.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this is just a housekeeping item. Going back to 2010, the term commenced June 1st, 2010. So what I need now is just a motion from